dog. You did some time to catch a jail for less time. You didn't like the way your tan was in the morning.
Is this thing on?
Whoa.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
You're welcome.
Guitar up.
One,
turn
two,
that guitar
three.
Up.
Hi, and welcome to In the Studio. I'm Red Beard, bringing you the stories behind the greatest rock and roll albums in history. Today we'll go in the studio with not one, but three enormously successful albums from a group named after the Windy City.
Lee always, although he's a trumpet player, he had taught himself how to play guitar. And for many of the years that we traveled, Lee and Terry would share rooms. And you know, so Terry was always playing, and Lee had his guitar, and he was always playing. They were playing together and separately. And something funny happened where, you know, Lee wrote the song, and it became a hit, and Terry said, "That's it, you're not rooming with me anymore." Hi, this is Robert Lamb of Chicago, in the studio with Chicago 567.
With their first four albums, Chicago took the Midas Touch one step further. Not only did everything they touched turn to gold, it went platinum. From 1969 to 1971, all four of Chicago's albums sold more than 1 million copies. At the same time, Chicago put four singles into the top 10. Each of Chicago's first three offerings were double album sets, featuring an average of 19 songs apiece. An unheard-of amount of music in such a short period of time. Then in October of 71, they pulled off their most ambitious project yet, an 8-sided live package complete with posters, concert program, and a pair of replica tickets from their record-setting shows at the prestigious Carnegie Hall. It was the first 4-record set ever released by a rock group. But something happened on the way to their next album. When Chicago 5 was released in July 1972, it was a single disc with 9 songs. Now that's quite a drop-off from a group that had released a total of 95 songs in the previous 3 years. Chicago's keyboard player, singer, and songwriter Robert Lamb explains what happened.
At that point, we had felt we had kind of pushed CBS to the wall with the Carnegie Hall package. We were prepared to do another double album, but I think we thought that at this point we should give them a break, and maybe even give ourselves a break. And we sensed that free-form things and lengthy solos perhaps were less interesting to everybody, including us, than more structured stuff. So we got into, like Saturday in the Park.
Written and sung by Robert Lamb, complete with a nonsensical line that only sounds like Italian, that's Saturday in the Park from Chicago 5. Going all the way to number 3 and selling over 1 million copies of the single, Chicago would not top that one until 1976. As Robert Lamb told me, Saturday in the Park was actually inspired by a couple of real-life afternoons in the park.
I carried a Super 8 movie camera around with me for the first few years we traveled, and I was looking at a reel one day of all my reels kind of spliced together in one long reel, and there was a section of it where it's Central Park in New York City in the summer. In 1969, we're in New York, and I think we just played the Fillmore, and we're kind of gathering forces to go down and play at the Atlanta Pop Festival. So it's like, I think it's actually the 4th of July, and I've got just some footage of me kind of wandering around the park, you know, this sort of like love-in type thing, you know, where they close the park off, and you know, people kind of actually come out and use the park. And then later on in the reel, I happen to be in New York the next year on July 4th, and there's more footage of, you know, people kind of riding their bicycles with balloons tied to them and that kind of stuff. So I kind of ran that film. I kept running those two sections and looking at it, and I wrote lyrics to describe what I was seeing. So in a sense, Saturday in the Park is like a little film score.
Back in 1972, the flip side of the Saturday in the Park single was a song called Dialogue. far more serious than the A side. Dialogue was the result of a conversation that Robert Lamb dreamed up one night.
I actually woke up in the middle of the night in, like, you know, a Holiday Inn somewhere, and without turning the lights on, you know, just kind of the light coming through the window, wrote down the words, and I heard the tune in my head, and you know, I heard it exactly the way it came out.
That's the way it ends. From Chicago's fifth album, that's called Dialogue. Chicago 5 became their first number one album, and it stayed there for 9 straight weeks in 1972. It also sold more than 1 million copies, giving them a perfect 5 out of 5 in that respect. With everything going so well, the last thing that the group Chicago would want to do is change their approach, right? Wrong. When it came time to record Chicago 6, the whole band moved to a remote area in the mountains near Denver, Colorado, called Caribou Ranch. According to Robert Lamb, this move was the brainchild of their producer and manager, James Guercio.
Jimmy Guercio had always talked about, you know, the utopian situation of you know, having our own studio so we could get into the studio anytime we want and, you know, do our little demos or, you know, just kind of be in a constant process of writing, you know, maybe in a situation where we would all live in close proximity to each other, you know, kind of, you know, in wilderness is our preservation. That whole Thoreau philosophy was something that Guercio strongly believed in and was trying to infuse into the group. When we were recording Chicago 5 in New York, we would stop recording and take a dinner break, and he would set up a movie camera and project movies of properties that he was having real estate guys all over the country looking for, you know, acreage that, you know, with buildings that could be converted to studios, you know, because he really wanted to do this thing, and he was really trying to, and you know, get the rest of the band enthused, you know, about actually making this move.
Caribou Studios was eventually built on the site of a former dude ranch, not far from an actual ghost town. Robert Lamb told us Caribou Ranch provided the perfect retreat for the group Chicago.
I think the idea was is that, you know, the record company, everything we thought about the record companies was true, and that they were really heading more and more towards the point where all they cared about was the bottom line. So if we wanted to really stay productive and to be captains of our own future, then it would probably be a good move to establish our own recording studio, maybe even our own label, and create a place where not only we could record and create and live in a better environment, but also provide a place where we could nurture other artists. We could lure other artists and say, you know, here's a place where you can write and record and kind of do the creative community thing that we are, you know, really started talking about when the band was formed.
With their sixth album, Chicago continued in the more streamlined direction that their previous album had taken them. Chicago 6 also became their second number one album in a row and brought the band 2 more hit singles. But as Robert Lamb fondly recalls, one of those hits, Just You and Me, was a lot more special to Chicago than its success on the charts.
Jimmy Pankow and his wife Karen had announced their plans to be married, and the announcement, either the wedding announcement or the invitation, had the title page of the sheet music reproduced on its cover. So rather than having sort of an engraved traditional invitation, it was the first sheet of that song, which he had written for Karen.
From Chicago 6, that's Just You and Me. Up next, we'll hear the track that gave Peter Cetera the confidence to become a contributing songwriter. I'm Red Beard, and you're in the studio for Chicago 5, 6, and 7.
Bach and bongo drums.
Some things were never meant to go together. Other things were always meant to go together, like the tastes in combo snacks. Creamy peanut butter on the inside, crunchy cracker on the outside. Only Combos combines 2 tastes that were meant for each other. That's why Combos is the one snack that's twice as good.
Here we go.
Give me the ball.
Over here.
Go, go, go. When you're burning up with thirst, when you're burning up inside, nothing cools you down like Gatorade Thirst Quencher.
Hey, now!
Bam, 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 bam! In there!
Fluid, mineral,
energy!
Gatorade is thirsty for that kick-up-bottom thirst!
Let's say you wanted to get the RCA release of Bruce Hornsby's A Night on the Town, but you had to pay for it by the beat. And let's say you went to one of those fancy music stores where you could only afford about that much. Nice beat, but the same amount of money at Kmart would get you a lot more of them. Because Kmart has it on sale for just $11.88 for CD or $7.96 for cassette. So don't miss a beat. Get the quality you need and the price you want at Kmart. But hurry, the sale ends August 4th.
So you'd like a job here?
Yes, sir.
Fine, just need to ask a few simple questions.
Sure.
What's the atomic weight of strontium 90?
Oh, that's...
Name a literary movement started by a group of French poets in the late 19th century. Less filling?
Tastes great.
The job's yours.
It is?
Sure, let's go get a Miller Lite.
Everyone knows there's one less filling beer that really tastes great. Miller Lite, America's favorite light beer.
Pretzels?
Little twisty, crunchy things, right?
Right.
Yes, Miller tastes great.
Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
Welcome back to In the Studio, this week highlighting Chicago 5, 6, and 7. I'm Redbeard. Prior to 1973, Terry Kath, James Pankow, and Robert Lamb had been Chicago's chief songwriters. But after the success of Feeling Stronger Every Day, Peter Cetera joined the songwriting ranks. Here's Robert Lamb of Chicago.
Jimmy Pankow and Peter Cetera, you know, almost by magic, came up with that song. And I couldn't tell you, you know, which part belonged to whom. But at this point, you know, Peter had been very secretive about and very insecure about his writing. You know, it would only be after a few drinks very late at night that he, you know, I would go over to his little house where he was living in West Hollywood, and he'd pull out an acoustic guitar and play these wonderful songs for me. You know, he had some kind of, you know, I guess insecurity about his writing. And, you know, I always said, you know, these songs are great, man. You know, why don't you present them? You know, why don't we do them? And Feeling Stronger Every Day, the success of Feeling Stronger Every Day, and having, you know, worked with Jimmy, I think is what opened the door for his later songs, which are great.
Peaking at number 10 in 1973, that's Feeling Stronger Every Day from Chicago 6. By this point, Chicago was showing they could go top 10 with remarkable regularity, something they weren't necessarily trying to do. Robert Lamb explains.
We really have not thought about the result too much. About the only planning we ever did was schedule sessions. And, you know, we had no agenda, really, other than, you know, just pretty much to record the songs that had been written. You know, all that's changed very much now. But at that point, Guercio was encouraging us to just keep writing and we'll record it. That was the last time, though. That record was the last time where we were able to pull that off, interestingly enough.
As we continued our conversation, Robert Lamb illustrated how the more successful Chicago got with singles, the more they found themselves at a crossroad. Should they continue with the improvisational, jazz-flavored rock that had first made them successful, or should they write more songs with simple pop arrangements? The decision became even more difficult when they began to get mixed messages.
From the fans, I guess what we were getting in concert and with the success of the records is, we love what you're doing. You know, this music you're playing is different and exciting, and it fills a niche that nobody else is filling. What we were beginning to get, though, from the record company, especially after Feeling Stronger Every Day, go ahead and do what you guys are going to do, but, you know, make sure that there's a hit on each album. We're getting to get a little bit of that message from the record company. You know, we love the fact that you guys are being successful and you're selling records, but the reason you're selling them is because you're having hit singles. So, you know, be careful. With the degree of success we had been having, everybody around us, the business people, the management, and the record company were saying, this is so great, we must find a way to sustain it.
The release of Chicago 7 in March of 74 marked the first time that all seven members of the group Chicago contributed a song to the album. This was great news for the three main songwriters, since they had always encouraged the others to write as well. Once again, here's Robert Lamb.
We had always done a thing where the writing members would share a portion of their writing royalties with the non-writing members, which is unheard of. Because basically Jimmy Panko, Terry Kath, and myself were writing, 95% of the stuff. So there were four other guys in the band, the income was beginning to be a little lopsided. So Guercio brought the writers together and said, what do you think about this idea? You take X percent and kick it into a fund, to a pool, and then redistribute it equally among everybody else. We said, fine, we'll do that, but what we think that everybody in this band is capable of writing, and we would like to see everybody, we'd like to give everybody a shot.
Chicago 7 also represented a return to form in many ways, after their previous two albums had strayed somewhat from their roots.
Danny Serafin and Walter Parizader and Lee Loughnane and Peter Cetera, everybody is writing now. And so there are four more people working towards composing, and that made for more material. And the basic project, the basic objective of this band was, for total expression and support for each other's creativity. So that, that made it almost necessary, absolutely necessary to do a double album. And also we wanted to stretch out more. I think we were encouraged by the success of Just You and Me and the jazzy solo in the middle. We thought that we maybe had been neglecting our jazz instincts a little bit, so we pursued that on Chicago 7.
That's I've Been Searching So Long. When we come back, we'll hear the real story behind the tragic death of Chicago guitarist and singer Terry Kath. I'm Redbeard, and you're in the studio for Chicago 5, 6, and 7.
Let's say you wanted to get the capital release of Hart's Brigade, but you had to pay for it by the beat. And let's say you went to one of those fancy music stores where you could only afford about that much. Nice beat, but the same amount of money at Kmart would get you a lot more of them. Because Kmart has it on sale for just $11.88 for CD or $7.96 for cassette. So don't miss a beat. Get the quality you need and the price you want at Kmart. But hurry, the sale ends August 4th.
Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, places my heart longs to be. The road leads ever onward, and it's calling out to me.
It's a great time to go Greyhound, because a Greyhound Money Saver can take you anywhere Greyhound goes for just $7 to $68 with a few restrictions.
Take a window seat on America.
Okay, Biff?
Ready?
Good. Camera's rolling and action!
Marjorie, without you, my life is less fulfilling.
Cut.
What?
Biff, the line is less fulfilling.
Less fulfilling. Less filling.
It's great.
Cut.
Whoa.
Let's go get a Miller Lite.
Everyone knows there's one less filling beer that really tastes great. Miller Lite, America's favorite light beer.
Here's your Miller Lite, Biff.
Why, I'm full.
Cut.
Less filling tastes great when it's
Miller Brewing Company, Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
Let's say you wanted to get the chrysalis release of Slaughter's Stick It To Ya, but you had to pay for it by the beat. And let's say you went to one of those fancy music stores where you could only afford about that much. Nice beat, but the same amount of money at Kmart would get you a lot more of them. Because Kmart has it on sale for just $11.88 for CD or $7.96 for cassette. So don't miss a beat. Get the quality you need and the price you want at Kmart. But hurry, the sale ends August 4th.
Welcome back. I'm Robert Lamb with Chicago, in the studio here with Redbeard.
Thanks, Robert. Just like their first six albums, Chicago 7 went platinum. It also became their third straight number one album. And one of the biggest hits from Chicago 7 was written by a then unlikely source. Here's Robert Lamb.
Call on Me is a composition that Lee Locknane did. And Lee always, although he's a trumpet player, he had taught himself how to play guitar. And for many of the years that we traveled, Lee and Terry would share rooms. And, you know, so Terry was always playing, and Lee had his guitar, and he was always playing. They were playing together and separately. And something funny happened where, you know, Lee wrote the song, and it became a hit, and Terry said, "That's it, you're not rooming with me anymore." After that, Lee would write, like, one great song for each album. I mean, it would, like, take him all year to write the song, and we would record it, and it would be a great song.
Written by trumpet player Lee Locknane, that's Call on Me. One of the other songs on Chicago 7, Wishing You Were Here, featured background vocals by another well-known American band. As Robert Lamb remembers, it was a stroke of luck that allowed Chicago to hook up with the Beach Boys.
When we would go to Caribou to do 4 or 6 weeks of recording, we would always pass through Denver and then take a bus from the Denver airport to Caribou. We had just gotten off the plane, and we were down at the luggage carousel, and who do we see? We see the Beach Boys, who are coming into Denver to play a show. So we sort of introduced ourselves. "Hi, how are you, Chicago? We're going to Caribou to record." Peter popped the question to Carl. You know, Peter said, "You know, would you guys be interested in coming up and have dinner with us at the ranch, take a look around, and maybe sing on something?" And they said, "Great, we'll be up there tomorrow." So I guess they played their show, and the next day they came up, and we gave them the tour of the ranch and sat down, had dinner with us, and the rest is history.
That chance meeting began a long and fruitful association between Chicago and the Beach Boys. In fact, the 1975 tour featuring the two groups proved to be one of Chicago's biggest successes. In a career filled with accomplishments, Chicago has sold more than 100 million records worldwide, enjoyed a streak of 5 consecutive number one albums, and had each of their first 12 albums go platinum here in the United States. Unfortunately, though, this story does not have a happy ending. Tragically, on January 23rd, 1978, guitarist-singer Terry Kath of the band Chicago killed himself. There have been many stories as to what really happened that day. So I asked Robert Lamb of Chicago to set the record straight.
We had just completed a very successful 1977 tour. We had done a world tour and then gone back and sort of done another half a world tour, a world and a half tour, and everybody was pretty burned and very tired. And something happened with Jimmy Garcia, and I. To this day, don't know exactly what it was. You know, it was something physiological. But the upshot of it was that we fired him. You know, we fired him. The relationship had gone completely south, and so there was a lot of disarray. There was a lot of discord. There was a lot of confusion, fear, anxiety. Individually and collectively. Now, you know, I think that plays a role in what happened to Terry. Now, Terry had always been a sportsman, an outdoorsman, you know, a collector and aficionado of guns and motorcycles and cars, you know. And he was, we were sort of still in this turmoil, and he was... he wasn't feeling real good. And the story that I've heard from one of my keyboard tech who was sharing a house with Terry was that Terry had come over to the house to play for a while. He had a complete, guitar rig set up, and he would just come over there and just play whenever he felt like, and he would leave. And he had just finished playing. He was feeling actually pretty good that day, and they were just sitting you know, sitting across from each other in the living room, and he had an automatic gun. Now, I have read that he was playing Russian roulette. Well, you don't play Russian roulette with an automatic weapon because it doesn't work. You know, it doesn't spin. Apparently, he had been cleaning the gun, and the cartridge was empty, but he had forgotten that there was a round chambered. And he just was sort of toying with the gun, had the gun in his hand, and pulled the trigger and hit himself squarely in the side of the head from like an angle that was sort of down near his side rather than, you know, right at his temple. So, you know, I'm convinced that you know, it was accidental. And, you know, all the stories that I've heard about being suicide or being Russian roulette, I know are not true.
Terry Katz's untimely death was a major blow to everyone in the band Chicago, but perhaps most of all to Robert Lamb.
I've always felt that, you know, the band forever changed from being Chicago. Even after the initial period of grief over loss had passed, I felt strongly that really we ought to just change the name of the band because it's not the same band. It's not a real rational thing to do because, you know, we're talking about the careers of six other people and the security of their families and commitments to the record company and, you know, a public which you know, loves the music and the band. So, you know, the decision was made to go on, and, you know, so there's still a Chicago today. But in my mind, the chemistry was gone when Terry died. You know, so what is left is the name of the band, the surviving members, and some new members, you know, building upon, you know, the first 11 albums. And but it doesn't have... For me, it doesn't have the same cohesiveness, urgency, depth without Terry. It's got different depth.
This is Redbeard, and I'd like to thank Robert Lamb for his extra efforts graciously documenting three of Chicago's finest albums.